Welcome to Aesop Community Church, where serving and giving begins. We look to the author and finisher of our faith, Jesus Christ, who demonstrated the greatest example of service and sacrifice. We believe by following his example, we can unlock the abundance of this life and be assured of our glorious, boundless future. As we gather here today, we acknowledge the power of the triune God. We offer sincere praises to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. We worship and adore the maker of the heavens and the earth. Indeed, we collectively affirm. We desire godly change in our lives. We are expecting God to meet us here in a mighty way. We are determined to leave this place wiser, stronger, more joyful, and equipped with biblical truth to help us conquer the week ahead. We expect God's best, leaning on Him daily. Leaning on Him for daily direction and resolving to renew our minds and surrender our hearts to His Word. We want to understand the true power, the true posture of worship, the power of earnest praise, and the blessing of hearing the Word and applying it to our lives. As we look around, we realize that serving the Lord is not confined to these walls. God gathers us here for instruction and sends us out to share the message of reconciliation. Acceptance of the shed blood of Jesus, His death, burial, and resurrection are essential to abundance in this life and the next. We are here to win souls for Christ, encourage those who do not know Him personally, and build up believers to accept Christ's call and to live a purpose-filled life. Everyone is welcome here at Aesop Community Church, where serving and giving begins.
The Lord with me, and we sing hallelujah. God, we thank you for this understanding. You allowed us to be in the land of the living. We thank you for health, and we thank you for strength. We thank you that we could have been so many places on this Saturday evening, but you saw fit for us to be here to hear a word from you. Bless us now as we open up this book. Bless us now as we go forward in you. Bless us now as we hear a word from you that we may apply it to our lives and move forward in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Well, it's another day here, Tuesday Town Hall at our Saturday Night Fellowship. I'd like to thank our visitor, Mr. Chauncey, for stopping by. His wife and he own the facility next door, so we're thankful for you. Thank you, Corey Franklin. Thank you. We thank you to the members who are here and the friends. It is indeed an honor to preach and to teach the Word of God to the people of God, that it may impact and improve your lives moving forward. I don't know about you, but anybody get tired of watching television? Did anybody just get sick and tired of seeing the same thing? I don't know about y'all, but it seems like no matter what I turn the channel to, it is the same thing. It is the same conversation, different people talking about the same thing. And I don't know about you, but in my mind, I'm like, when is it ever going to stop? When is the nonsense going to stop? When are people going to take responsibility for their life, for their choices, for their actions? It's like everybody wants something, but nobody's willing to put anything in to get the very thing that they want. And I don't know about you, but I get tired. I don't think I really watched television the last 2 weeks. I think I've just turned it off. I don't want to see anything because it's the same thing. People are struggling and fighting for basic necessities in life, and it doesn't seem like the people reporting going to give you any answers, any clues, open up any doors, or shed any new light. When I realized that if you truly want to have life or light, you need to study the Word of God, because every answer is in the book that we're dealing with. So it seems that no matter what your circumstance in life is, there is a page for you to get out of the very predicament that you find yourself in. And I think the thing that consumes our society is wealth, is money. And what does money do? You can be an ugly guy with money and have a pretty woman. It's a fact. There's nothing new about it. You don't have to be good looking when you have money. And it seems like, I don't know about y'all, but I've been around some pretty successful people in my life. And it seems like one thing I know for sure that money does, it enhances your outward appearance. I remember when I met Danny Aiello, and I said, man, he looks good. His skin was smooth. His clothes were crisp. His cologne was something I had never smelled. And I realized it's because of his wealth that he is able to obtain some things. I was walking around with Brute 33, $2.99 from the drugstore. So what I'm saying is that we are inundated with these images of what money will do and can do in your life. And I'm not going to lie, money does make life easier, but it is not the answer. And if you think that having money is the answer, you are surely mistaken, and you have not lived long enough to understand that money is not the answer. It is what dwells on the inside that's connected to your heart, which will give you the joy in your life. And so that brings me to tonight's sermon. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Mark, the 10th chapter, and we're going to read verses 17 through 22. That is Mark in the New Testament, chapter 10. Verses 17 to 22. And the reason why this message tonight is so prevalent, because if you really get it, if you understand and how these scriptures will play out in your life, you'll understand that it's not the wealth that you should be looking for, but it's the joy in the Lord that will enhance your life and give you the wealth that you very need on the inside. Because people are so busy trying to look good on the outside, but are jacked up on the inside. And so in Mark, what we're dealing with is that Jesus, as he has done, has taught, he has healed, he has delivered, and he is going from one city to the next. And we come across this particular verse of scriptures. And what you have to understand is, if ever there's an accident and two or three or four people see it, you notice that each one will have a different account of the very thing that everybody saw at the same time. So this particular passage was also presented by Matthew and Luke, and each one pretty much had the same consistency, but had a couple different variations to each one. So I'm just going to talk about Mark. And the reason why I want to talk about Mark is I want to just zero in on what he saw and how we can apply this to our lives. So Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 22 reads as thus. Now as he was going out on the road, one came running, knelt before him, and asked him, "Good teacher, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?" Verse 18 says, "So Jesus said to him, 'Why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Do not defraud. Honor your father and your mother.'" Verse 20 says, "And he answered and said to him, 'Teacher, all these things I have kept from my youth.' Then Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, 'One thing you lack. Go your way, sell whatever you have and give to the poor. You will have treasure in heaven, and come, take up the cross and follow me.'" Verse 22 says, "But he was sad at this word and went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions." My title is simply, "Your possessions are not your position." Your possessions are not your position. So what are we talking about here? We're talking about, based on the different accounts of this particular situation, a young man. He was a ruler. That's what they said he was. He was a ruler, which means he had what? He had authority, superiority, and he had wealth. And those are some combinations for deadly destructions. When you find yourself in a position of authority, therefore, sometimes you don't think that people can tell you anything because you're in a position of authority you think you know all. When you have wealth, it allows you not to deal with the mundane things in life. Meaning if you have enough wealth, you don't have to clean your house. You don't have to cook your own food. You don't even have to cut your grass. But when you have wealth, does not mean you have peace. And here it is, this young ruler knew about Jesus. He had heard about Jesus, and it says that as Jesus was going out, that he came running. Why would he come running? He would come running because whenever you know somebody has something great for you, you don't hesitate to get there. So even in his position of authority as a young, wealthy ruler, he had enough sense to know that this guy has a key to something that I desire. Maybe my wealth can buy for me, maybe my wealth can't buy, but I'm going to go to him and see, how do I get this thing? How do I inherit this thing called eternal life? How do I get it? What is it? Is it something that's special? Is it something that's wrapped up? It said he knelt before him, which means what? He showed reverence. And see, in our society today, we don't have reverence. We don't have authority. We don't respect for the authority. And that's why we have so much chaos, because there is no authority in the house, which means there's no authority outside the house, which means there's no authority in the community. Why? Because people don't have reverence for the position. But that this young ruler had enough sense to know that I'm going up against someone great. That he knelt and showed his reverence. And then he did what? He asked a question. And his question was simply, "Good teacher, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?" He asked the question. His question was, "What must I do?" Anytime you know anything about God, you know all you have to do is ask. But because of his wealth and his training and his upbringing, he thought he had to do more than that. Why? Maybe because he had navigated some deals that made him successful. And every deal that made him or brought him success, he had to do some things. So I guess he thought being and dealing with Jesus was no different. What must I do to inherit eternal life? You got to understand that this encounter with Jesus is not only paramount for him, but it's prevalent to us today. Because sometimes you may ask yourself, what must I
do to get this eternal life? And it's simply today, ask Jesus to come into your life, knowing that he died and rose for you. It's not something you can buy. He paid the price. How can you pay the price greater than him giving his life? So this man was eager. He came running to get an answer to a question that he had pondered, that maybe he had thought about. He just wanted to get this answer, and who better to go to than Jesus? And Jesus does not give him the answer immediately. Why? Because whenever the answer comes quickly, you might not have time to let it marinate. But the answer is given to you instantly. He just gave out the answer immediately. There's no opportunity for him to teach. There's no opportunity for him to delve into this one's life. So sometimes the answer doesn't come as quickly as we need it. And that's when you have to learn patience. So it says in verse 18, so Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. And what is he saying to the young rich ruler? What he's saying to him is, if you equate me with good, then you can't give honor to the Father who is good, who is sinless and blameless. I am too blameless, but I'm only here to do his work. And I want you to put your eyes on something bigger than me, God by himself. Although we are part of the same, yet God sits high, I sit to the side. All I'm trying to tell you is that Jesus is setting him up for something. You got to see the setup, because first of all, you got to realize, what did he do? He came running. He came to ask a question, and Jesus didn't give him an answer. He gave him a question. So Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. So Jesus hears the question. And you know that Jesus knows the answer, but he wants to hear from us. He wants to hear from you. He wants to hear what your answer is to the question. And based upon your answer, he knows exactly where your heart is. He knows where your mind is. He knows where your life is predicated on your answer. And your answer will only be pleasing to God if you know the word of God. That's how you can please God, by knowing his word. And so when you look at this, he says, no one is good but God. God is the one. He's not denying who he is, but he's informing this man. And he's telling us that the true God that comes from the Father is good. And that's why I have a hard time when we spend our days talking about who's great. How can you be great when God considers himself good? Everything that he did, he said, it is good. It is well done. I am pleased with what? Thy good and faithful servant. Not thy great servant, just thy good. So then Jesus, he says to the young man who's asking the question, how, what must I do so I can inherit this eternal life? And God has already let him know who he is and who the Father is. And then he comes back to the very question. He says, well, in verse 19, you know the commandments. And then he goes through a list of the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Do not defraud. Honor the father and the mother. But if you know anything about the commandments, there's some more. He didn't give them all. He just gave him some. Now, I don't know why he gave him some. Maybe up until this point, the young man had lived up to those things because he was a young man. And maybe as we go a little bit further, we'll find out that the very ones that Jesus omitted was the ones he was having problems with in his life. Sometimes you can't get everything on the first day. And so he tells him, you know these commandments, because all of these are going to lead way to salvation. No, it's the foundation of your life. Is the foundation of how you walk. Your salvation is going to come through Christ. So he tells them, you know the commandments. And so you got to picture this scenario. Jesus is talking to this young man, and this young man is eager. He's zealous. He wants an answer. He in his life, he doesn't have no financial problems. He's young. He still has energy. And Jesus said to him, you know the commandments. And you know what that young man says? Just like any one of us. He says to him in verse number 20, And he answered and said to him, "Teacher, all these things I have kept from my youth." Man, look, I know that. I know those things. I've been taught these things. I've been raised in the church. I've been raised in the synagogue. I've been raised to know what Moses came down with. I know all of that. I didn't get to this position in my life but not knowing these things. These things helped me get here. You haven't answered my question. My question is, how do I inherit this eternal life? I know it can't be the commandments, because in that case, I've already obtained eternal life, but something in me is still gnawing. Something in me is still has a void. I still need to know, what must I do? And you haven't given me the answer yet. You're still testing me. I don't know if I'm passing or I'm failing, but I believe that my reply puts me in the position to know I'm no dummy. Because I've done all of those things. I have kept those things in my youth. I was raised that way. And you know how we say it? I was raised in church. And some people know a lot about church because they were raised in church. And I'm assuming that this young ruler was no different, because he tells us in verse 20, he says, I've been this way my whole life. I know I'm not supposed to do those things, but I'm not comfortable. I got possessions, but my position in life is off. I've kept the law. I've kept the commandments. But yet something is still missing. I need to know about this eternal life. And that means that Jesus already knows, and this young man is what? Thinking. And that's how we are when we're faced with certain circumstances in our life. We hear a question on top of a question, and our minds get to twirling. We have an answer, and we come back with our answer, and we think that we got you there because you ain't told me nothing, Jesus. I already know that because I've done that. Verse 21 says, and this is when it gets to be what we consider good. This is when you get to see the separation. This is when you get to see Jesus versus your human mind or your human thoughts. This is when you get to see why Jesus is who he is and why he or we are who we are. When we are dealing with spirituality, when you're dealing with someone who is sinless and blameless, you can't trick them up. You can't trip them. You can hide around us. You can pretend to be something in front of us, but you can't deny who you are when Jesus, who created you, already know. You can't trick him. So ain't no sense in you trying to come out here with a facade, because Jesus already knows him. And in verse 21, it exposes the young man for who he really is and what he's seeking in life, that God makes it very crystal clear. It says that Jesus said, looking at him, then Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, Jesus was looking. Can you listen? You got to see that for yourself. Jesus, not the pastor, not your parent, not your mother, not your father. It says Jesus, looking at him, loved him. Didn't say in love, found love. It said loved him. Why? Because Jesus is a God of compassion, which already meant to Jesus when he said he loved him, because he already knew where this young man's heart was. And God had to have sorrow for him because he knew the answer before the answer came. But the young man didn't know what answer he was going to give, predicated on what was in his heart. It has to be in your heart. It can't be in your mind. It can't be in your thoughts. It has to be in your heart. Then Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, One thing you lack. He says, go your way, sell whatever you have, and give to the poor. Have I not preached enough in this church that our service to the poor is the reward from God? We want to grow predicated on our service. I don't have to go out there and preach on the street corner. All we have to do is serve and give, and by default, eventually those seeds that we plant will manifest itself. I'm telling you, it's not about how good you can preach or how well you can sing. It is about your heart, your service to give and be used by God. That's it. And no matter what else happens, no matter what people may think on the outside, on the inside, you know you're doing it the right way. You keep moving forward. You keep blessing people. You keep helping people. And God says to this rich man who had an abundant amount of money, he said, one thing you lack. And I know that young man, his ears were eager because he thought he had already answered the questions that God had given him. He had shown reverence. He came eagerly. He said, what must I do to inherit this? And then Jesus told him, one thing you lack. Go your way, sell whatever you have, and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Do you know that is the hardest thing for anyone to do? That if you're living good here, you can't imagine living better in heaven. He's telling him, the one thing you lack, young man, you've done all these things from the law. You have been raised in the tradition of your home. But the one thing you lack is that your wealth supersedes your judgment. He says for him to sell everything that he had, give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. He will have treasure where? The very place he said he wanted to inherit. But look at what he does. And come, take up the cross and follow me. The hardest thing in the world for a person of authority to do is to follow. It's to follow. And I'm here to tell you that if pastors could learn to follow, this community would be saved, this state, this country. Why? Because it's about following. But everybody got to be on the microphone. We can't have everybody on the microphone if we're trying to do something for the Lord. But the problem is everybody wants to be heard and show what their abilities are to articulate the word and break down and exegete. All I'm trying to say, I ain't got time for that when my brother is sick. I ain't got time for that when my child is hungry. I ain't got time for that. We got to be about God's business. Jesus walked every way and healed and blessed and taught along the way. Got time to be fighting battles that are not mine to fight. And so when Jesus got to this young man, he said, sell everything and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come take up the cross and follow me. Jesus loved him. His heart was broken because he knew the answer before the answer came out of the young man's mouth. Who can't love? Who can't love? If you can't love, you're missing the valuable part of life. Life is about loving. And Jesus, he loved him and he told him to sell and give it to the poor. You can't tell a rich person to sell everything and give up the life of luxury, the life of privilege that they had, and give to the poor. Don't you know that if you do that, you will have a greater reward? I can't tell you the names of some of the successful people in Hollywood, but I know there are some executive producers who made millions upon millions of dollars in Hollywood producing shows, and they were unfulfilled. And one day they decided to give it all up and took the money and went and opened up places that would help people who were struggling in life. And they said these words, I have found more success in helping and giving than I did being the executive of TV shows and producing and movie stars and being a part of that. He's telling this young man the same thing. If you want to inherit, you can't buy it. And I believe this young man was thinking that he was going to be able to pay his way into eternal life. And Jesus is telling him that if you want this, young man, and you said that you wanted it because you came to me, I'm telling you the answer, not the answer you want to hear. And we find that in our families. Your parents tell you the correct answer, but it's not the answer you want to hear. So what happens when you hear an answer you don't want to hear? You get mad. You try to defend it. You try to rationalize it in your own mind. But in fact, the matter is truth is truth. Truth is truth. And this is no different here. He was not willing. So you say, how do you know he was not willing? Verse 22 says it all. But he was sad at what? This word. He had rejoiced, knowing he had done all the other things of the commandments. But at this word, he was sad. And he went away sorrowful, for he had what? Great possessions. Your possessions are not your position. When you leave here, your possessions stay here. There ain't nobody going with you. It may be some tokens in the casket with you, but you are on your own when your departure day comes. John Witherspoon was a good friend of mine, and he was a very genteel man. He was very, very caring. And one thing they asked him, they said, John, when you were always around the country and people saw you, they said, bang, 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 and you got to coordinate. Did that upset you? He said, absolutely not. You know why? Because those very things made me. They allowed me to be who I am. How can I be upset at something that had made me who I am? He didn't buy into his wealth. He understood that his testimony would come from all those who poured out emotional testimonies by saying how much of a kind man he was, a mentor and a friend to others. Don't you understand? That is true wealth. This young man went away sorrowful. Why? Because he could not give up the position he had in life. He could not give up the authority he had in life. He could not give up where he lived and how he lived and how he was revered. And all I'm telling you is if you are so concerned about that, you're missing the mark. The mark is very simple. It's about serving. It's about giving. It's about helping our brothers in need and our sisters in need. It is about being an example to these young kids and being there for these older folks. It's just about unity. It's about all of us coming together collectively and living and realizing what God has done in our lives. This young man, he walked away sorrowful, for he had great possession. He was not willing to give up just that to follow Jesus. He wasn't willing to take care of the people. He wasn't willing to follow Jesus. And that's why Jesus loved him. And he looked down. He looked at him with probably eyes of pity, knowing that he was not going to be able to give up his life when he didn't even realize that the life he had was given by the one he was talking to. Your possessions are not your position. Your position is in your life and how you live to glorify God. Where will your soul end in eternity? My prayer is that your soul will end in eternity. This body is temporary. Our living circumstances are temporary. But your status in heaven is eternal. I don't want you to live a meaningless life. I want your heart to be right. And I want you seeking God and blessing and leading an example for people to follow because it's Christ's life. If you want to be successful in life, understand that your wealth comes in your service to mankind. And I guarantee you that not only will God bless you, people around you will be blessed, and our homes and our communities will be better off. Yes. Because you'll be living. Yes. To serve the true and living God. God bless you, and we thank you, and I thank you for being here tonight. And if I had 1,000 people here, they would be running around stomping and clapping and saying, was that not a good word? Was that not a good word? Even Chauncey got to say, you got to admit, you know you're coming back. You know you're coming back. Well, God bless you, man. I thank you, man. I'm telling you, there's no greater joy than to preach the word of God to the people of God, because God gives this information for us to absorb. He gives it to us, and it's free. You don't have to work for it. You don't have to fight for it. All you have to do is study to show yourself approved. And I guarantee you that if you get into the volume of the book and start meditating on it, your life will change. You'll be forever changed, and you will be in a better position moving forward, knowing the simplicity of all of this is to hear it and apply it and move forward. And each day, grow closer to God, closer in your walk to Him. And all things that were in your past will be in your rear, because you'll be moving forward. Don't let your back, your rear, or your background, or your previous days define you today and how you're moving forward. All you have to do is keep moving forward in Jesus' name, and He will direct your path. Well, God bless y'all, man. I'm so thankful that you came out. If the doors of ASAR Community Church are open, and here at ASAR, it's very simple. If you want to be a member of our church, all you have to do is fill out this card. It says, I want to be a member. And on the back, there are two questions you have to answer. Number one is, why do you want to be a member of this church? Because you need to know why you're joining the church. Some people join the church because their parents are there. Some people join because it's close. Some people join because they know the pastor. I don't know. I think you ought to have a deeper reason of why you want to be a member of the church, and what ministry do you want to serve in. You don't have to serve in two or three. Just find one. If we don't have one for you, create one. Just do something. Get your hands dirty, and I guarantee you that God will clean them. Tuesday is our town hall. That's our Bible studies every Tuesday at 7 o'clock, and all you have to do is just pass this out to someone. It has all the information on it. Here at ASOM Community Church, we believe in serving and giving. We don't take an offering. If you want to sow into our ministry, you just fill out this envelope right here. You place it in the silver containers. If you want to give online, you go to ASOWCC.org, and you can give online. Whatever you give, we will use it for the ability to provide a place for you to come to hear the word of God. That's what we use the money for. We use it to take care of our pantry. We use it to take care of some of the ministries that we support throughout the city of Villarrica. There are several ministries. Matter of fact, we just supported another ministry that came to our attention called Rare Pearls. It's a mentor group for young girls between the ages of 7 and 17, and we sold into that ministry this week. We are just trying to make sure that we are accountable for the resources that come in, that we make sure that we utilize them for what God will be pleased with, and that is helping and serving in the community. And God has given us the resources to do that, and we're just trying to do that and be pleasing in His sight. So again, you can go to asomcc.org, or you can fill out one of the envelopes here in church. With that being said, I want to make sure y'all know that I'm wearing Roger and Gloria's cord. They are up in Tennessee today. With their business, and I wanted to make sure, plus it went with my sweatshirt, so I put it on. Not a Georgia Bulldog fan, but I have it on. And also, I'm wearing a sweatshirt from Aaron Cole. If you watch the Dove Awards, Aaron Cole won a Dove Award for Best New Gospel Artist, male rap, best new. So this was one of his sweatshirts they were selling, because you gotta understand, he won a Dove Award, but I hope he writes a book about the journey to get to the Dove Awards, when he would go around and perform at the West Ends in Atlanta, and it'd be 11 people listening to him in the middle of the mall, and they were selling sweatshirts and t-shirts and hats to put together demos and tour and just so much. And now he's a Dove Award winner, and last night he was performing in Memphis, Tennessee, so I wanted to show my support to both businesses, Aaron Cole and Roger and Gloria. And so with that being said, I think that's it. All minds are clear. Chauncey, thank you. Your beautiful wife, thank you for coming. To our members, God bless you. Father God, we thank you right now as we depart from this place. Bless us and keep us, Father. Let the words that were preached tonight and the songs that were sung tonight stay on the hearts and the minds of the people as they go forward, that their tomorrow will be better than today. Bless us now as we depart, but never from your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.